Distinguished members of the jury, it's a great pleasure for me to have an opportunity. Great pleasure for me to have an opportunity to come before you and speak to you. Having been denied this opportunity to carry out other investigations into Protective Edge.
Can everybody hear all right? Because I was a bit concerned last. All right, I'm sorry, it's a bit difficult. If you could just talk towards the microphone so they carry properly. I was just going to do one short couple of matters with you so everybody understands. First of all, Desmond Travers, it is, you've got his CV. I'm not going to go through it. Is it right that you gave evidence in Barcelona in relation to matters that we were considering then, and obviously that was cast lead in the past, and you were part of a mission that examined what had been going on in Gaza on an earlier operation, is that right? If you'd like to say yes.
Yes.
I don't have this problem normally with witnesses. So, yes to that. But also, I just wanted one other thing, is that you have tried very recently to go to Gaza, I think twice, and you've been stopped twice actually getting there.
Yes.
Right. Now, in that context, therefore, your past experience and your attempts this time, I think you are familiar with the kind of weaponry and munitions employed and deployed by the Israeli army, and perhaps you could extrapolate on that.
Yes, thank you very much. I had hoped to visit Gaza last week and investigate some of the impact sites that were particularly of concern during this military operation called Protective Edge. Unfortunately, I was deprived of that opportunity, but I did receive a very large dossier of video and photographic material from the Palestine Center for Human Rights and a very good verbal briefing from its director, Mr. Raji Sarani. And I have been able to share that material with serving military colleagues in more than one army who are very, very anxious to come and assist me with this work because, like so many people around the world, became concerned with the use, suspected overuse, or misuse of a vast array of weaponry during this operation called Protective Edge. And their work is ongoing. For that reason, I don't have all the answers, neither do they, but we have the great preponderance of the answers. When speaking about munitions, it's my view that you cannot speak about it in isolation. You have to speak about the tactical rationale for the use, overuse, or misuse of munitions. You may even have to speak about the strategic rationale for the use of munitions. It's also necessary to speak about doctrinal and rules of procedure and rules of engagement matters to justify or explain the use of these munitions. And finally, it's necessary to enter into a discourse about the consequence of the use of these munitions. And to study the consequence of these munitions, it is necessary to look rearwards a few years and look at what happened as a consequence of the use of munitions during previous conflicts in which the Israeli Defense Forces participated. So that's my agenda. I hope it's satisfactory. The munition issue is a very large issue, and I have to say also that I will share my dossier with the jury, of course, and I do hope my subject is on track. The previous operations were the IDF, Hezbollah conflict in Lebanon in 2006, and the Operation Cast Lead. Both of these operations I have participated in either as an observer or as an analyst or as a member of a fact-finding mission. The Lebanon conflict was particularly significant in that there was excessive use of cluster munitions. And the significant thing about the cluster munitions is that when they do not explode, they become anti-personnel mines. What I found interesting from an analysis point of view is that the cluster munition failure rate during the Israeli invasion in 1981 was 18%. The failure rate in 2006 was 40%. I lead you to draw your own conclusions as to how a technology can disimprove. It was, I think, for that reason that the international community and human rights organizations managed to get enough leverage to proscribe the use of cluster munitions. And this was brought into effect by 140 signatory states, I think. I have to say also, privately, the holders and stockholders of cluster munitions in the Western world, such as France, Britain, the United States, and then the Russian Federation, that was not a popular one. And I think I have to make a pointer about this, because if the question of proscription of munitions becomes an issue or a subject for recommendation by the tribunal, I would like to suggest that there will be resistances to such measures. That's one of the problems with prohibition or proscription of munitions. CASLED was a very interesting military operation from my perspective, in that the early bombardments that took place on the 27th of December and subsequently, in my view, corresponded to a doctrine that had become controversial but fashionable in certain quarters called shock and awe. And the idea of the doctrine of shock and awe is to so saturate an area with violence that it freezes a defender's capacity to respond or take decisions. Now, why that should be visited on an undefended community such as the city of Gaza beats me. I can offer a theoretical explanation for it, but I cannot offer a rational explanation for it. But the significant evidence of the shock and awe phenomenon was the overuse, misuse of white phosphorus. And this was flashed on our TV screens around the world. Some 3,500 artillery shells jettisoning some 400,000 wedges over the city of Gaza. It's my view, and I have to be honest about it and say it's my view sometime after we submitted our findings to the High Commissioner for Human Rights, that there would be long-term consequences of CASLED, and that those consequences were deliberately put in place in the last week of that three-week operation in a sub-operation called, or nicknamed by the Israeli Defense Forces, for the day after. And I began a study of this and the weekly reports from the Palestine Center for Human Rights, and I presented my findings of that study to a group of academics in the United States in October, November of 2012. I just want to illustrate to you what I think was put in place in that closing days of CASLED, and I think it has a bearing on what we have to consider with regard to protective edge. First of all, the so-called buffer zone was expanded to approximately 1,500 meters. And interestingly enough, the maritime blockade was reduced from 6 kilometers to 3. If you take a close look at the implications of that, and I took one of the worst affected areas with the Beit Hanun district, you will find areas such as no-go areas and high-risk areas. And these have been plotted on UN maps, and in effect, gave inadvertent legitimacy to what the Israelis sometimes like to call facts on the ground. If you calculate the loss of the vegetation, for example, 140,000 olive trees, 136,000 citrus trees, 130 farms, irrigation systems, water systems, greenhouses, glasshouses, you effectively suppress the productive capacity of 68% of the arable land of Gaza. I emphasize that because no other human rights organization is coming up with this statistic. They come up with a statistic of 35%. I am stating now it's 68% if you take into consideration 1,500 meters, limited capacity to produce agriculture, and the fact that Israel have put the citizens of Gaza on a diet, and this is the effect of it. So, what has happened in that interval of time to this area and in throughout Gaza in general? When I visited Gaza last year in February, one of the concerns I had was of the effects on the soil, desertification, anomalies in the soil, anomalies in the vegetation, which arose from the use of certain munitions or certain chemicals, and other such effects. What really, really surprised me was the information from the Union of Agricultural Work Committees, who informed me that the waters that traditionally migrate from Israel through the three wadis that go through Gaza towards the Mediterranean, those waters had stopped. And the waters are known to have been diverted to a reservoir in the Negev. This has huge implications, not alone for the soil, where the engineers in the municipal water authority were able to tell me that they are now beginning to see sand dunes in Gaza, where sand dunes had not been seen before. Not alone has this implications for the arability of the soil of Gaza, it has implications for the replenishment of the coastal aquifer. I think I've gone one too far. Anyway, I'll keep talking. The coastal aquifer is expected to be irreversibly damaged by 2016. My view is that these processes are accelerating this irreversible damage, and that this is a coordinated and deliberate action. When you look at the closure of the blockade on the sea, you find that there is an interesting coincidence with gas exploration in the area. And on the illustration I have up here, you will see that the nearest gas platform is 14.7 miles out. It's called the Mari B. And it is my view that not alone was the sea restricted to 3 miles, but it was also closed down by 1.8 miles from the international border between Israel and Gaza. And that was deliberate to ensure the security of the extraction of that gas. I am not inferring that this gas is in the territorial waters of Gaza. I'm not saying that. I'm simply saying that the motive for the restriction from 6 miles down to 3, and the shrinking of the seascape arose far from the need to secure access to gas. That gas field is now depleted. In fact, it dried up in 2012. So we must now look further afield, and we find that recently the buffer zone, or the sea buffer zone, has been extended to 6 miles, and the reason it's been extended to 6 miles, in my view, is because the gas field is no longer an issue. A pipeline has been extended out to the NOAA gas field, which is further out, NOAA South, NOAA North, and work is already in place extracting gas from there. Some of that field crosses into the territorial waters of Gaza, so there is a question as to how much gas is going to be extracted and whether that gas will be allowed to be used by Gaza. Can I just say that this gas issue was huge. If gas was made available and allowed to be exploited, it would enable the people of Gaza to rest the aquifer, establish their own desalination system, and use their own power and energy. I am not going to speak about the medical consequences because my distinguished colleague, Dr. Mads Gilbert, is here. Safe to say that there is a concern about the number of weapons that have been used, and there is a concern about toxicities. And some of those concerns, if they are similar to the type of use and overuse that occurred in Fallujah, there is likelihood to be a statistically elevated instance of health issues in the years to come. And I don't want to be a harbinger of bad news when we can't be sure about it, but that would be my concern and my view. Now we come to protective edge. And just briefly to mention the fighting units that were involved, because these were the same two fighting units that were in Cast Lead. There was a third fighting unit in Castlet called the Airborne Brigade, but the Golani Brigade and the Givati Brigade seem to have been allocated the ground holding and attack operations in this area. The munitions use, I've categorized them because it's familiar with us in the military to categorize, but all I can say with certainty is that 90%, maybe more, are familiar to us and would have been the same munitions that were used during Castlet. There is, however, something else and quite a different matter at issue. And that is that the quantities of munitions that have been used, in my rough estimation, is a multiple of a factor of 7 compared to Castlet. Raji Sarani informs me that their own calculation is 2 metric tons per square kilometer, giving one an overall estimate of 760 tons of munitions have been launched, fired, or dropped in Gaza over this 50-day operation. My own calculation is that the artillery ammunition alone was 1,000 tons. So we can speculate as to the tonnages that were put into play. I'm just going to show you some footage and some photographs that were taken during Protective Edge and identify them for you and talk about the weapons that were used and their purposes. One of them, the slide you're looking at is that of a paveway bomb destroying a building. It's often called a Mark 80-82 munition. It's about 500 pounds weight. It's astonishing the number of fired and unfired ones that were shown to me on video. I would say 40 or 50 of them. And it's astonishing to consider that for every habitation that was destroyed in Gaza, one of those devices was used. It means statistically, in my view, that the amount of munitions that were launched, dropped in Gaza, would exceed what might have occurred in Central Europe for most of the cities there during the last war. Five? Okay. So there's the munitions we see that have been strewn around the place. There's a Mark 84, it's a 2,000 pound bomb. Many of those were used. This one I suspect might have been used to create the huge craters and were used to destroy the tunnel systems. There is no doubt this was taken in Gaza of the drone or UAV armed with missiles. This is a flechette shell used primarily now in the Israeli army by reservists. It's an inappropriate weapon to use. It's an area weapon and it produces unacceptable injuries because it tumbles when the flechette strikes human flesh. This gives you an idea of the tonnages and the quantities. In or about $20 million worth of artillery shells. I just wanted to show you a short video of a bomb called a carpet bomb, which is a thermobaric bomb. It's a fuel air bomb, and it's used extensively in Gaza on this occasion.
To modern APCs, wheeled or tracked vehicles. High breaching efficiency is assured with up to 20 rockets primed with fuel-air warheads. When the fuel combines with the oxygen in the air, it creates an explosive cloud that exerts a downward pressure of 20 atmospheres for several milliseconds.
I'm leaving it at that because I have a suspicion that this was a munition that removed the lower limbs of young men during Castlet, or decapitated children, or cut people in half because of the airburst effect. Many of these projectiles have been found. Now, just very briefly, I'm going to talk about some of the munitions that are a concern. Depleted uranium has to have been used in the tank ammunition because it's the standard component used to harden the warheads of cannon in modern armies. Whether it is toxic or not is very controversial. All I'll say is that it's like the modern Irish ghost story. You know, the modern Irish ghost story is, no, I do not believe in ghosts, but no, I won't spend a night in a haunted house. The same with depleted uranium. Governments have actually gone public and said there is no hazard from depleted uranium, but no, we will not send our soldiers as peacekeepers to an area where depleted uranium has been used. So you have to try and balance that one. Dime, I think Dr. Mads will comment about it because he can talk about the exceptional injuries that it occasions. It's a powder metal mixed with explosives. White phosphorus has been used again, but hasn't been used in the manner in which it was used during cast lead. And indeed, the Israeli militaries have agreed to limit its use as a result of court action. Flechettes is continued to be used, but it's being phased out because it's no longer the munition in the modern Markava Mark V tank. It's in the old tanks, but they're still using it. And now we have this fuel air bomb, thermobaric bomb, which I've just illustrated for you. The doctrines that give rise and legitimize this kind of behavior have already been discussed, but I do believe that the one that bothers me most is the one by the ethicist Professor Asa Kasher, and the reason I am concerned about that, and I would like to talk about that for a minute, or maybe during questions.
Well, I'm going to turn it into a question.
All right.
Because there's another doctrine which you may be related to it. It's in your notes, and that is the Dahir doctrine, which stems, I know, from a campaign in the Lebanon. If you could expand on the two points, please.
Well, Dahir is a district in southern Beirut, occupied by Shia, who are considered to have been sympathetic to the Hezbollah message. And Dahir gave rise then to a doctrine of over-response. To create, in the idea of some of the theorists or the applicators of this doctrine, it was to create a lasting memory of the consequences of their actions by over-responding. And the idea was that, for example, if a village in South Lebanon harbored one sniper or one member of Hezbollah, the entire village would have to pay the consequences.
Sorry? Carry on.
So that was the Dahir doctrine, and that doctrine has, our report condemned it, and I think other reports have condemned it also as unjustified.
I just want to ask a follow-up question, and that is that doctrine, in fact, focuses on the civilian, non-competent population.
Absolutely.
So it isn't a military objective at all?
No. It's a punishment. It's a consequence. And as one general says, to make and create a lasting impression of consequences in the minds of those that are targeted.
And in order to do that, it involves destroying a group.
I don't think I could go so far as to say that, because I don't know what you mean by group.
A village.
Perhaps, yes.
Now, I want to ask you a little bit more about also one other question, and others may have other questions, and that is, the weaponry you've described in brief form today, to what extent is this weaponry being either funded or provided by other third parties, in particular either the USA or the United Kingdom?
Well, the markings on most of the munitions that I've seen are of US manufacture. But a fairly considerable number of the standard conventional munitions like artillery shells and mortars are also of Israeli manufacture.
And a supplementary again to that, in terms of the forces on the ground, is it now established that there are members of the United Kingdom, citizens of the United Kingdom, that have joined up improperly in the IDF?
That I do not know.
You don't know. All right.
But since I am now aware of your area of concern, can I talk about the Asa Kasher theory?
Yes.
Because there is a consequence in it that has not been discussed before. Asa Kasher wrote a paper called Targeted Assassinations, and in it he discusses the idea of the concept of the Israeli soldier as a citizen, and therefore as a citizen, every reasonable effort must be made to protect him from when he's on military operations. And in consequence of the desire and the necessity for defending the Israeli soldier, he goes on to suggest that combatants or non-combatants in an area of operation in which Israeli soldiers are functioning, they must look after themselves, or at least the non-combatants are not the responsibility of the Israeli soldier. Now, this has given rise to a whole series of military actions that are very, very troubling. For example, rules of engagement by the two brigades I've mentioned make it a court-martial offense to allow a Palestinian to come close to an Israeli post, and make it a court-martial offense if a person, a Palestinian, comes to within 20 meters of an Israeli post. So what you actually have is the over-application of the rules of safety to the detriment of the civilian population. You have the transference of risk from the soldier to the civilian. And in my view, you have a deculturation of the concept of valorous behavior. In other words, the Israeli military ought to take on board the fact that this is not in their best interest in the long term. If the concept of valor and selflessness is removed from the military, you have now a new organization. It could be an organization of gunslingers, as far as I'm concerned. So that the valorous concept is hugely important, and this has now been removed. So that's my argument against the Asa Kasher theory. Yeah.
I want to ask a supplementary to that. The Israeli authorities have established, or at least indicated they wish to establish, killing zones, zones in which anybody who moves get killed, irrespective. It's happened in Gaza before, but it's now spreading to other zones. How does that interrelate to the theories you've been talking about?
Well, I haven't experienced killing zones, other than my own doctrine and my own army, as a tactical norm. But you're really talking about warfare. You're talking about a war. Is this a war we're talking about? Is the Israeli insertion into Gaza on a war footing, dropping these carpet munitions and then moving in with armor, is this appropriate for what might be described as an insurgency operation? It's crazy.
Right. Yes, certainly.
I wasn't very clear, Desmond, what you said about white phosphorus.
Yes.
Could you just clarify? I know it was used a lot in Operation Cast Lead, but I wasn't very sure just to what extent it was used in this last one.
Well, I've studied the debris, and there is evidence of quite a bit of use. But I have to be very honest and say the use I am aware of was tactical, operational, and I don't have an issue with white phosphorus in this operation. And I actually make the point that there are two successes, in my opinion, with respect to Israeli behavior during the Lebanon War and in Cast Lead. One was the prohibition and the elimination of the use of cluster munitions, and the other was in the excessive overuse or misuse of white phosphorus. And maybe these offer us strategies for further limiting Israel's range of military action. I do not know.
I wonder, we hear so much about Gaza being used as a lab for testing weapons.
Absolutely.
And if these weapons, you say, are mainly made in the United States, could you just speak a little bit to that, to the issue of testing weapons?
I've certainly seen and proven, and we actually mentioned it in our report, the testing and the marketing of one weapon during the notorious Al-Fakura Street attack, when they dropped three shells, killed 31 people, and injured very badly 34 others. And there was no doubt whatsoever that it was the marketing and the testing of a new weapon called the Keshet. And which is interesting from a war point of view is, who was firing it? Was it the manufacturers, the workers in the factory, or was it soldiers? And I could go on that. Interestingly enough, a year later, the Keshet blew up and killed 2 Israeli soldiers and injured 5. And then it was withdrawn from service. Killing Palestinians, 5 times that number of Palestinians make it a good weapon. Killing 2 Israeli soldiers make it a bad weapon.
Where was that weapon manufactured?
I'm sorry?
Where was that weapon manufactured?
Oh, in Israel. It's an Israeli weapon. Yeah. It's back in service again, by the way.
Can I just ask a supplementary question too? Because when we saw this video, it's very hard as a layman to know just the extent of territory that it covers. The bombing looked incredible. And especially when you put that together with the Israeli statements that they are trying to target resistance fighters. Can you just give us an idea, perhaps, if a bomb was dropped, just how many meters that would cover?
Well, I think in reality, it's never fired singly. It's fired in salvo, so that there is an area, several football fields wide and several football fields long, through which armor can move and advance. Because armor will never move in a single lane. It's too vulnerable. So you're talking about a brigade, maybe 40, 50 tanks or associated mechanized vehicles, armored personnel carriers, tanks, and so forth. And you're talking about a wide area of maneuver that is eliminated or wiped out by this salvo effect.
I think Ronnie Casrell's got a question.
When President Obama immediately after the attack on Gaza said that the United States would replenish weapons used, or munitions used by Israel, which ones was he specifically talking about? The ones you've described?
My understanding was the Congress voted $240 million midway through Protective Edge for the replenishment of Iron Dome. Now, here's the interesting thing. Iron Dome is a complete failure. A complete failure. The Israelis declared that during Protective Edge that it eliminated 27% of the missiles that they decided to take on. And I know one analyst who has studied the footage and said the hit rate was as low as 5%. Now, and you're talking about very elementary rockets, usually flying on empty. There's no propellant within the rocket in order for it to travel far. Potential buyers are not interested in a missile system that can just about hit the occasional rocket. They're concerned about incoming missiles, which have evasion capacity and other attack evasion capacity. As far as I'm concerned, it's a waste of money. All right, thank you very much.
Yes, thank you very much indeed.
Thank you very much.